Good afternoon. Glad you could join our live stream today for our worship service. If you've never joined us before, my name is Mark. I'm the pastor here. Glad you're with us. City Presbyterian, we are a Salt Lake City church that strives to make Christ's love public. And one of the reasons that we gather for worship is not just to gather together to have a good time. I mean, that's part of it, but we gather together to draw near to God, to experience His grace and mercy, and that's what fuels us to go out into the world and to make His love public in the world as well. So we believe that God has come to us in the person of Christ and made Himself known, making Himself public, and it's Him who we gather for worship today. We, hopefully, if you're on our email list, we have sent out to you a bulletin that has the order of worship for today. And at the very end of the bulletin are some announcements. I just encourage you to look over those. Some announcements about the groups that we have that are meeting together and who the contact person is for those groups. We have a men's group, a women's group, Northside Community Group, what we call city groups. There's also information there about our service that we're doing at the Homeless Youth Resource Center, where we're a few of us are gathering to serve meals to kids in need. So Mitch Thomas is the contact person for that. Also, today we started our online Zoom membership class, and if you're interested in hearing more about City Pres, we have that going on, and you can contact one of us on the session. Our session is our leadership that includes Danny Malin, Justin Smith, or myself. One other thing, we know that a lot of you have been longing to be together again for worship services, to gather again, and what we've decided on as a leadership team is that once there are 5 consecutive days of 2,000 cases or less in Utah, of 2,000 coronavirus cases, that along with the capacity at the for the ICU being down to 80%, anything 80% or below in the ICU, the capacity of the ICU, along with 5 consecutive days under 2,000, that is what we're hoping for and looking forward to in order to gather again for worship. So we'll have... So keep an eye on that, or keep an eye on your email, because hopefully that will happen soon. With that, God is a God who calls us to worship. He calls us to come to Him, to give Him honor and praise that He is worthy of, and to draw near to Him because He is gracious and loving. So the call to worship is printed there. It's from Psalm 8. I'll go ahead and read the unbolded part, and together we'll read aloud the bolded. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is Your name in all the earth. You have set Your glory above the heavens. Out of the mouths of babes and infants, You have established strength because of Your foes, to still the enemy and the avenger. When I look at Your heavens, the work of Your fingers, the moon and the stars which You have set in place, what is man that You are mindful of him, and the son of man that You care for him? Yet You have made him a little lower than the heavenly beings and crowned him with glory and honor. You have given him dominion over the works of Your hands. You have put all things under his feet, all sheep and oxen, and also the beasts of the field, the birds of the heavens, and the fish of the sea, whatever passes along the paths of the seas. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is Your name in all the earth.
When I in awesome shout of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall bow in humble adoration and then proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
Our Old Testament reading today is from Job 1, 1, 2, 1 through 10. There was a man in the name of in the land of Uz whose name was Job, and that man was blameless and upright, one who feared God and turned away from evil. Again, there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan also came among them to present himself before the Lord. And the Lord said to Satan, "From where have you come?" Satan answered the Lord and said, "From going to and fro on the earth, and from walking up and down on it." And the Lord said to Satan, "Have you considered my servant Job, that there is none like him on the earth, a blameless and upright man who fears God and turns away from evil? He still holds fast to his integrity, although you incited me against him to destroy him without reason." Then Satan answered the Lord and said, "Skin for skin, all that a man has he will give for his life. But stretch out your hand and touch his bone and his flesh, and he will curse you to your face." And the Lord said to Satan, "Behold, he is in your hand. Only spare his life." So Satan went out from the presence of the Lord and struck Job with loathsome sores from the sole of his foot to the crown of his head. And he took a piece of broken pottery with which to scrape himself while he sat in the ashes. Then his wife said to him, "Do you still hold fast your integrity? Curse God and die." But he said to her, "You speak as one of the foolish women who would speak. Shall we receive good from God, and shall we not receive evil?" In all this, Job did not sin with his lips. The word of the Lord.
To God. And let us respond with a doxology.
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here.
All right, we come to our children's sermon now, and have a question for all those who are participating and listening today. I know you can't respond to me directly because we're over through YouTube, but the question I have is, what are some of the things you are afraid of? Maybe some of you are afraid of spiders. Or maybe some of you are afraid of a loud thunderstorm, or afraid of the dark. There's all kinds of things in our world that are kind of scary. Or if you maybe have heard news, you've seen news on television, often there's things that are reported on there that are kind of scary. We live in a world where there's things that make us afraid. Well, the passage of scripture that I am going to be talking about, the story that I'm going to be talking about, can be a little scary. It's a little intense. And one of the reasons is that it's intense is because it's talking about something that's kind of hard for us to understand, because it's talking about the spiritual world and spiritual forces in the world that are hard for us to understand. And the story is about a man who has within him demons. Now, these are kind of a scary thing to think about, but if you think we've talked about angels and before, and you've heard about angels, well, and they're helpers of with God, they're on God's side. Well, you have demons in the Bible as well, and these are kind of evil forces, and so it's a little bit of a scary story that we're talking about today. And the man, it makes this man do some things that are strange and not right. Things aren't right with him, but he meets Jesus, and Jesus has come into the world to defeat these things, to defeat Satan and to defeat the demons, to defeat the things that are opposing of God, and to make things right. And the thing that I want you to understand is that we don't have to be scared, because God is more powerful than demons. He's more powerful than anybody or anything. And we can trust him because he's loving also, and he wants to make things right, and he does make things right. And he is the one who defeats evil for you and for me and makes everything right, because he's more powerful too. So I just want to encourage you with that. And my prayer is that we would grow more and more in our understanding that God is the one who defeats evil. And he did this most clearly when he went to the cross to die for your sins, for my sins, and to resurrect from the dead, revealing not only that he takes care of sin so that we can know God, but that he is most powerful over anything and everything. So let me pray for you, and we'll continue with our service. Oh Lord, we thank you that you are powerful and that you love us. Help us to all to understand that more clearly. In Jesus' name, amen.
He has hushed the lost loud cry. As Mark mentioned in the welcome, we are in the midst of our membership class. For people who are interested in becoming members and actually just anybody who wants to attend. And members, when they join, are asked to make a series of vows. And the first of these vows has nothing to do with directly with serving the church or, you know, being under the leadership of the session, but it has to do with recognizing where you stand before God, which is to say that you are a sinner in the sight of God and justly deserve his displeasure and are without hope except in his sovereign mercy. And so we have a confession of sin every week as a way for us to liturgically be in the discipline of fulfilling this vow, remembering that there are things in our lives which are not acceptable to God, which drive us away from God and each other, and that we are in desperate need of mercy and salvation and transformation. So let's remember those things together today. Holy God, you have saved us out of slavery and brought us to life, yet we exalt ourselves over you. We have built idols in our hearts and replaced the Creator with the creation in our affections. We misuse your name and dishonor the Sabbath you have given us for our benefit. With our fellow image bearers, we have fought from birth, not honoring our parents. We hate our brothers and are guilty of murder. We lust and are guilty of adultery. We greedily hold that we should freely give and are guilty of theft. We slander our neighbors and covet their blessings, ungrateful for the blessings you have poured upon us. Have mercy on us, sinners, undeserving of your grace, and sanctify us through your perfect word and the work of your Spirit, purchased and justified by the precious blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, in whom we pray. Amen. Let's take some moments for a silent confession today. Friends, God is calling you to himself to turn away from sin and to turn towards him. And he gives you an assurance, and that assurance is Jesus. Jesus will take you there. Hear now this assurance of pardon from Hebrews. Now, in putting everything in subjection to him, he left nothing outside his control. At present, we do not yet see everything in subjection to him. But we see him who for a little while was made lower than the angels, namely Jesus, crowned with glory and honor because of the suffering of death, so that by the grace of God he might taste death for everyone. For it was fitting that he, for whom and by whom all things exist, in bringing many sons to glory, should make the founder of their salvation perfect through suffering. For he who sanctifies and those who are sanctified all have one source. That is why he is not ashamed to call them brothers.
Yeah. Our sermon passage today comes from Mark chapter 5, verses 1 through 20. They came to the other side of the sea, to the country of Gerasenes. And when Jesus had stepped out of the boat, immediately there met him out of the tombs a man with an unclean spirit. He lived among the tombs, and no one could bind him anymore, not even with a chain. For he had often been bound with shackles and chains, but he wrenched the chains apart, and he broke the shackles in pieces. No one had the strength to subdue him. Night and day among the tombs and on the mountains, he was always crying out and cutting himself with stones. And when he saw Jesus from afar, he ran and fell down before him. And crying out with a loud voice, he said, "What have you to do with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I adjure you by God, do not torment me." For he was saying to him, "Come out of the man, you unclean spirit." And Jesus asked him, "What is your name?" He replied, "My name is Legion, for we are many." And he begged him earnestly not to send them out of the country. Now a great herd of pigs was feeding there on the hillside, and they begged him, saying, "Send us to the pigs, let us enter them." So he gave them permission. And the unclean spirits came out and entered the pigs, and the herd, numbering about 2,000, rushed down the steep bank into the sea and drowned in the sea. The herdsmen fled and told it in the city and in the country. And people came to see what it was that had happened. And they came to Jesus and saw the demon-possessed man, the one who had the legion, sitting there, clothed and in his right mind. And they were afraid. And those who had seen it described to them what had happened and the demon-possessed man and to the pigs. And they began to beg Jesus to depart from their region. And he was getting into the boat. As he was getting into the boat, the man who had been possessed with the demons begged him that he might be with him. And he did not permit him, but said to him, "Go home to your friends and tell them how much the Lord has done for you and how he has had mercy on you." And he went away and began to proclaim in the Decapolis how much Jesus had done for him, and everyone marveled. This is the word of the Lord.
All right. Not sure. I've been wanting to avoid this passage. Not because it's not awesome, but it's difficult when we're talking about the things that this passage is talking about. But let me start just reminding us, those of you who have been with us or those who are joining us for the first time, we've been in a series in the Gospel of Mark and looking at the kingdom of God, looking at the life of Jesus. And today we come to this strange passage, a story of what's referred to as the Gerasene demoniac. And we may not always have the right language and frame of mind to understand a story like this. But what we need to keep in mind here is that the Bible is clear that evil exists, that there is true opposition to God, against God's will, rebellion against God's will. But in the end, God will overcome all the powers of evil. That's the story of the Bible. So as we read sections of scripture like this, stories such as the one we looked at last week, the calming of the storm, when Jesus calms the storm, or when we look at this healing of the Gerasene here, even though we may and we should insist on natural explanations for disease and for storms, we must not forget the real power of evil, its real opposition to God and his will. So the passage, again, is the one that McKenna just read for us, Mark 5, 1 through 20. Let me pray for us as we dive into this one. Oh God, we need you. As we talked about, Danny talked about in the confession of sin, we are all sinners in need of you. And so we pray, God, that even during this time, you would help us, that you, by the Holy Spirit, would help us to understand your word in such a way that it would draw us to yourself so that we can know you more, so that we can know your power and your mercy, your grace toward us, and so that our lives can be changed, Lord, that you would do your work in us. Help us, Lord. Speak to us by your Holy Spirit. This we pray in the name of Christ. Amen. So what's happening in this story? Real quickly, after the calming of the storm, Jesus and his disciples get in a boat, or they're in the boat, but after the calming of the storm, they get to the other side of the Sea of Galilee and are met there by a man who has some serious problems. And we are told that he didn't live in a house, but lived among the tombs. He's a man possessed by many demons. He was chained and kept under guard. However, at times he would break these chains and be driven by the demons into the wild. But Jesus meets him. And the demons are crying out to Jesus to come out. And Jesus gives them permission. They come out of the man and they go into the pigs. And these herd of pigs rush down this steep bank and into the lake and are drowned. It's crazy. This story's a little wild. It's a little hard to understand. The townspeople see all this that's happening and they are overcome with fear. But the man from whom the demon has gone out is now sitting at Jesus' feet, dressed and in his right mind. Jesus then gets in the boat and leaves, and the man begs to go with him. But Jesus tells him to go home and tell his friends how much the Lord has done for him and how the Lord has shown him mercy. Okay, it seems a bit out there. But according to the Bible, there are demons. Modern people often think, you can't really be serious though, right? Demons? But why not? If you are sure that God doesn't exist, then it's logically that demons don't exist. However, the vast majority of people believe that a God or a supernatural good exists. And if a supernatural good exists, then why couldn't a supernatural evil exist as well? Some will say, but ancient people didn't have the understanding to explain things like mental illness and epilepsy. They didn't have the understanding that we do today. So that is why ancient people attributed things like mental illness or epilepsy to demons. But we know better now, they would say. Perhaps some of this is true, but what does Scripture say? It actually supports the idea of the demonic by differentiating things like mental illness with demons. If you were to look at Matthew chapter 4, verse 24, it says this: so his fame, that is Jesus's, spread throughout all Syria, and they brought him all the sick, those afflicted with various diseases and pains, those oppressed by demons, those having seizures and paralytics, and he healed them. Those opposed by demons are differentiated from these other diseases and sicknesses. So the passage we are looking at today is really talking about evil forces. It's talking about a battle between God and evil. About this kind of cosmic conflict, Dostoevsky wrote this: God and the devil are fighting there, and the battlefield is the human heart. So let me ask you this today. Where is your heart in relationship to God? Let's look at this with these questions in mind. How does evil work? How is evil defeated? And then what does this mean for us, in our hearts, in our lives? First, how does evil work? Now, while there may not be much demon possession today, the Bible wants us to see that there are evil forces at work that are real and exist, and they exist everywhere in our world. We don't need to look too far to see this, right? Last week was Holocaust Remembrance Day. We've had things such as slavery, the atrocities done to Native Americans. We've had events like Sandy Hook that happened. All kinds of evils. But do you know the Apostle Paul writes in Ephesians that even things like cynicism, bitterness, are influenced by evil forces as well. He writes elsewhere that pride and arrogance are influenced by evil forces. So we may not know anyone who has ever been demon-possessed, but the Bible clearly teaches that demonic forces are at play in the real world. This is why so many people are living enslaved, living in bondage, rather than experiencing the freedom to truly flourish as human beings. Look at this description here of the Gerasene man in verses 2-4. And when the Gerasene stepped out of the boat, immediately there met him out of the tombs a man with an unclean spirit. He lived among the tombs, and no one could bind him anymore, not even with a chain, for he had often been bound with shackles and chains, but he wrenched the chains apart, and he broke the shackles in pieces. No one had the strength to subdue him. The evil forces in his life led him to have this incredible strength and power, so much so that he could break the chains. And while strength and power are not always evil, anything that we look to give us strength and power other than God is what the Bible describes as an idol, something sinful. If we make anything other than God more important, then we are giving ourselves over to that thing, and you become enslaved to it. I feel like I'm even more susceptible to idols in the midst of this pandemic, wanting something to bring me a sense of comfort or happiness. But this man really makes a pact, in a sense, with evil. And the result is that he has greater power, but he's also enslaved. When you sell yourself to idols, when you give yourselves over to them, you get something. You might get something from it, but you lose a lot more. So you might get power, or you might get beauty, or you might get success, and yet still be enslaved. If you make anything more important than God, that thing is your master. So let me ask you this. What is the thing that gets you going in the morning? That makes you feel good about yourself? Whatever that is, is what controls you. In a book called Out of the Salt Shaker, Becky Pippert says this: whatever controls us is our Lord. The person who seeks power is controlled by power. The person who seeks acceptance is controlled by acceptance. We do not control ourselves. We are controlled by the Lord of our lives. Whatever you center your life on, that is what you've made a pact with. It could be recreation. It could be success, career, relationships, anything other than God. If something like a career becomes your main thing, you might become successful, but on the other hand, enslaved to it as well. Now, while we might think it's impossible to have something like this happen in our day, something like this that's happening in this story, the passage brings something else out that is important. Verse 3, he lived among the tombs, and no one could bind him anymore, which means this probably happened gradually to this man. Sounds like he probably didn't set out to become who he had become in this story. He didn't set out to end up where he did. It could have just kind of gradually snuck up on him. And our idols can do this in our lives too. Things can just sneak, kind of gradually come into our lives, and we end up being enslaved to those things. Gradually, we can think something like, or we can have something like bitterness or envy or something creep into our lives and end up, as one pastor says, in the tombs of bitterness and unforgiveness, or in the tombs of pride and arrogance, or in the tombs of an addiction. Suddenly you wake up and you think, how did I get here? How did my marriage become this? Gradually, sin can happen gradually. Sin and evil bring about enslavement and they lead to destructive things in our lives. And if sin and evil can take this kind of control over not just systems, but people, what hope do we have? Which leads me to the next question. How is evil defeated? Well, we need to recognize who it is that has the power to defeat it. Looking at verses 6 and 9, and when he saw Jesus from afar, he ran and fell down before him. And crying out in a loud voice, he said, what have you to do with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I adjure you by God, do not torment me. For he has said to him, come out of the man, you unclean spirit. And Jesus said to him, what is your name? He replied, my name is Legion, for we are many. It says here that the demon calls himself Legion. And this is a military term used for a large number of soldiers. How many is a legion of demons? It's thousands. And Jesus says to him, come out. Now, if we look at history, anyone who's ever tried to do an exorcism calls on a higher power to do the work of casting out. But Jesus doesn't do that. Why is that? Remember last week, Jesus, with the calming of the storm, Jesus isn't worried about these powerful forces. He isn't worried about the legions of demons here either. He says, come out. And he doesn't call on a higher power because he is the higher power. Even a legion of thousands is no contest for Jesus. Don't we long for someone who can make things right and who can free us from enslavement? Don't we want that in our lives? This is who Jesus is. This is who he is. He is the one who comes to defeat evil and make things right. And he has the power to do that. How does Jesus do this ultimately? How does he ultimately defeat evil? Well, in Colossians 2:25, Paul says this, he disarmed the rulers and authorities and put them to open shame by triumphing over them in him. Ultimately, what Jesus would go on to do is to conquer evil and death, finally and completely. He did this at the cross. We are told here that the Gerasene man in this story is naked because he is enslaved by evil. Jesus becomes naked, opening himself to shame on the cross to defeat evil. This man's enslavement led him to cut himself with stones. Jesus was voluntarily cut by whips of Roman soldiers. This man is led to cry out. Jesus cries out from the cross, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. This man was separated from his community. Jesus on the cross is separated from the community of the Trinity in that moment, calling out, my God, why have you forsaken me? And he did this for you, and he did this for me. Jesus would take on all the powers of evil on the cross so that you and me, those of us who believe in him, would go free. Have you trusted him? Are you continuing to trust him, that he has dealt with your sin, that he's done something about it? Jesus defeated evil by putting sin to death and burying it with him to rise victoriously, conquering all that would enslave us. So, what does this mean for us? What should our response to this be? To get at this, let me first talk about the pigs in this story, because I know you're wondering about the pigs. This is odd, right? What's going on here? No one really fully knows. If you read commentators on this passage, even some of them don't give a great explanation. They don't really know what's going on. But what some scholars do tell us regarding this passage is that demons do not belong to humans, in humans. Jesus shows us that. He casts the demons out of the man, and they are driven over to the pigs and driven off of a cliff, done away with. Jesus is saying to these demons, no longer will you enslave and abuse people. Now, I know some of you are wondering about the pigs, and I get that too. But what Jesus is ultimately saying is that no longer will they enslave you. Look with me at verses 14 through 17 here. The herdsmen fled and told it to the city and in the country. And people came to see what it was that had happened. And they came to Jesus and saw the demon-possessed man, the one who had the legion, sitting there, clothed and in his right mind. And they were afraid. And those who had seen it described to them what had happened to the demon-possessed man and to the pigs. And they began to beg Jesus to depart from their region. The thing we need to see here is that the townspeople observe all this that's happening, and they don't care that this man has been brought and put to into his right mind. And they don't really care about the life of the pigs either. What they're upset about is perhaps the loss economically because of their farming pigs, which they would have made a living by. So they are afraid about they're afraid about the reality that Jesus will strip them of their idols, things they trust in for life, with just his very presence and his word. He will strip idols from people's lives. And so just as they are presented with the power of Jesus, we are too. And we have a choice. Are we going to allow sin and our clinging to idols influence us and control us? Or are we going to receive what Jesus has done for us in defeating the very things that enslave us? We need to remember that no evil has power over the one whom Jesus resides in. No evil has power over the one that Jesus resides in. When you turn to those things you look to for life, will you turn to those things that you look to find life in, or will you turn to him and trust him? And finally, are we going to trust Jesus in such a way that we are enabled to receive the words to go out and tell other people what has happened to us, to proclaim him in the world? This is what Jesus does. He wants us to go and he wants us to understand that he is the Almighty, that he has come to defeat sin. And he wants us to go out and to proclaim that in the world. Jesus defeats evil, frees us from sin, to live for him and to tell others about him. Will you do that? Will you receive the good news? of the gospel, that Jesus has done what we couldn't do ourselves. And will you go tell others the good news? Let me pray for us. Lord, we thank you that you have done something about our biggest problem, the problem of sin in our lives that separates us from you. But you've defeated it on our behalf. Help us to trust you. Help us to put our hope in you and not other things. And then, Lord, lead us out of gratitude for what you've done to go out and to proclaim you in the world. Would you do this in us? This we pray in the name of Christ. Amen.
At this point in the service, we talk about unity among Christianity and what that means. Who are our brothers and sisters? When we think about the story from the Gospel of Mark that we just heard, I identify with the demon-possessed man because that was the power that I had, not the strength. Not the strength, but the power to save myself was the same. It didn't exist. And so my ability to be saved came only through being freed by Christ. And so when I'm thinking about unity in this context, it's not the unity that I have with people that believe X, Y, Z, or these particular things. The unity that we have with other Christians throughout history, across the globe, that unity is with those who have been freed by Christ. It's not something that they've chosen. It's not something that they believe. It's not a matter of how they administer baptism. It's a matter of our unity is with those who have been freed from the tyranny of the devil. Let us consider that as we answer the question, what is your only comfort in life and in death? That I am not my own, but belong body and soul in life and in death to my faithful Savior, Jesus Christ. He has fully paid for all my sins with his precious blood and has set me free from the tyranny of the devil. He also watches over me in such a way that not a hair can fall from my head without the will of my Father in heaven. In fact, all things must work together for my salvation, because I belong to him. Christ, by his Holy Spirit, assures me of eternal life and makes me wholeheartedly willing and ready from now on to live for him. And now we look at this time of at offering, where we take a moment to give back from a small portion of the riches that have been given to us by God. The best way to give right now is to go to citypresbyterian.org and to click on the link that says Partner with Us. If you would like the donation to go to the Benevolence Fund, you can make a note on there. That is obviously, while we're not meeting together, the best way. Hopefully, there will be more ways to give soon as we will be back together. Pray with me for the offering. Father, we thank you for all that you have given us. We thank you, those of us that have been able to continue to work throughout the last year, that you have blessed us with that opportunity. And we pray for those that have not been able to continue to work, that you will watch over them as we know that you do. We pray that you will bless the offerings that come in, and that you will give wisdom to the leadership of City Presbyterian as we seek to use those to further your kingdom and to give aid to those in need. We ask these things in the name of your Son. Amen.
We have, as always, a great number of petitions and also praises to bring before the Lord. And so I'm going to lead us in that, and then we will then all pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us. So let's go before the Lord in prayer. Lord, we come before you as we do week after week in states of contradiction, even between each other and in ourselves. We have great joys and also great troubles. And all these we bring to you. Lord, there are those of us in this body who are feeling more and more the weight of separation from each other in this pandemic. And it's manifesting as feelings of depression, isolation, an inability to act, and just a general malaise. Lord, I want to pray that you will be with us in that, that we will be able to see you sitting beside us, that suffering is not something that you are a stranger to, but that you became intimately acquainted with for us. Lord, we are also celebrating the birth of a new child. We have a new Bortz in our midst. And Lord, we are grateful for this. We ask you to be present, of course, in his new life, but then also the lives of all the children. Because Lord, children are the church right now. Lord, I thank you that I'm reminded of that by Justin, that we are not waiting for children to be the church, that they are the church. And Lord, when we look at them, we see persons to whom the kingdom of God belongs. Lord, thank you for them, and we ask you to help us raise them well and protect them. And Lord, at last, I ask again for this pandemic to lift. We have great hope in the work that has been done in vaccination and care for people. Lord, we are thankful that humans have been given intellects to understand the universe and to be able to use what is in it to help heal hurts. But in the end, there's only so much of us. We can't overcome without you. And so we ask you in all ways to step in. As a prayer that I heard many years ago, and I thought was really good. Lord, have mercy on us, because the ocean is so very big and our boats are so very small. Let's pray together now. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours forever. Amen.
I'll send you now with a benediction from Hebrews chapter 13. Now, may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good, that you may do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen.